0344 499 1000. Let's talk to Dr. Paul Stott, research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society, because as I mentioned to you earlier on, we need to talk about this ridiculous situation on YouTube, where you can still go and watch a lecture by Islamist hate preacher Anwar al Awlaki. Dr. Paul Stott, very good morning to you. Welcome.
Good morning, Mike.
Thanks very much indeed for joining us. I mean, this is a very surprising situation, given not least the fact that YouTube has become supposedly quite good at kind of curbing extremist content on their platform. Certainly they've stopped people from the right wing of politics in this country, or the extreme right wing, if you want to call them that, from being able to upload videos and to monetize them. How is this guy allowed to do it?
Well, that's an important question, because Anwar al Awlaki is arguably the most important propagandist that Al-Qaeda developed. And this is somebody, an American of Yemeni heritage, who lived for a short period here in the UK, and who spoke English as his first language, who fully understood Western, the Western way of life, and was able to, if you like, turn some of our weaknesses, turn some of our characteristics back on themselves in his propaganda. So, for example, in one of his videos, Mike, he talks about jihad becoming as British as afternoon tea, or as American as apple pie. And this was something very different to, you know, some of the mosques in the UK that were at the time dominated by old Pakistani clerics or whatever who didn't speak English. This was somebody who not only spoke Arabic, the language of Islam, but spoke good English, understood the West, and supported Al-Qaeda.
And according to a piece in the Times this morning, there's over 100 of these videos, propaganda speeches, whatever you wish to call them. And at least some of those were used by Usman Khan, the London Bridge terrorist, recently killed by the police here on Friday, to help radicalise him.
Yes, and if you look at the reports at the time of the conviction of the Al-Mahajirun plotters that Khan was part of, Anwar al-Awlaki's influence was mentioned at the time. And so, you know, the authorities and technology companies like YouTube have had long enough to address this if they want to. One of the issues, I think, for a very long time with social media companies is, as soon as some questionable materials found it's taken off, it goes straight back on again. So to give you one example, I can remember right at the start of my academic career, 2009, 2010, giving a lecture, and I showed students a clip of this jihadi hip-hop track called Dirty Kafir, and YouTube took it off, I think, a few months later. It's gone off and gone back on again on YouTube pretty much continuously for the best part of a decade now. And I think one of the problems that these companies have to address is that some of them, YouTube in particular, are actually quite successful at keeping pornography off the site.
Yeah.
So they can keep problematic content off when they want to, when they're focused on it. In other cases, they seem to really struggle. If you're going to focus on anything or anybody from the sort of Islamist and jihadist canon, Anwar al-Awlaki is in the top three. There's absolutely no question about that. The Americans killed him in a drone strike in Yemen in 2011, but there's still an enormous amount of his material out there, either in PDF form or videos, recordings of his speeches. And that needs to be, it really does need to be addressed. You'll find, for example, the Charlie Hebdo killers in 2015, you know, they'd been out to Yemen, they were clearly inspired by some of al-Awlaki's arguments. So, you know, the guy's influence lives on, even though he's been dead 8 years.
And is that the case, that there is a sort of an ongoing organisation, if you like, punting this stuff around?
No, I don't necessarily think it is. I know some organisations in the past worked with al-Awlaki who certainly shouldn't. You know, this is somebody who, when he was living in the UK, perhaps wasn't quite as extreme as he became, but who spoke at meetings of university Islamic societies, spoke at events from Yemen connected by the internet in the UK for, you know, groups like CAGE, who had previously spoken for the Muslim Association of Britain. So I think there's some real problems the guy's legacy. What you tend to see at the moment, I think, is much more, you know, people in their bedrooms who've got this material on old laptops or whatever, and they're putting it up, circulating it, recirculating it, certainly in the West. Whether there's other, you know, collections of material in Yemen, I'm less sure of. A lot of what you're going to see coming up on YouTube is going to be coming from Western sources.
Yeah, and is it just a sort of a sheer volume problem, I suppose, for YouTube? But you say earlier that, you know, they can stop stuff going up there if they want to. Do you think they need to put more people on this, as it were?
Well, I think they do. And I mean, if you look, you mentioned some of the right-wing material that they've, I think, probably been more successful at taking off. There certainly seems to have been concerted periods where all of the social media platforms have decided Tommy Robinson's coming off. And they've taken him down in a very short period of time across a succession of sites. I think they need to be as committed to doing the same with Anwar al Awlaki, and they need to do it quickly.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Dr. Paul Stott, thanks very much indeed. You can call us, of course.